Well, good evening. Welcome to our State of the Church talking portion of the evening, not the eating portion, but our conversation about what we have accomplished in the past year and what we seek to accomplish with God's help in the coming year. It's really great to be here tonight. I was thinking about the last time we did this, and last year at this time, my arm was in a sling. I barely remember that, but at this time, I'd been on the job about 6 months, and I had taken that time to invest in getting to know you and getting to know the church, and talking with the visionary board. And our State of the Church event was an event where we would unleash a new vision and the work of the visionary board, and kind of get the assessment that I had made of where things are and together where they could be. Last year it seemed to be a pretty well-received event by the congregation, so we said, let's do that again. Let's keep our commitment to transparency and communication so that everybody knows what's going on and has the opportunity to be included. So that's what we're here tonight to do. And we're going to have some time for questions and answers at the end of the evening. So if you are the kind of person that has a hard time remembering the questions while they're coming into your head, you might want to grab one of the kids' doodle pads or something, a piece of paper or something, and jot down those questions as we go along. And then we'll have the opportunity at the end to address any questions that you would have. So let's begin, though, with a time of prayer. Let's pray. O Lord, we celebrate who you are and who you have created us to be. We thank you for the gift of this church and for the impact that we are able to make together for the sake of your kingdom. As we spend time this evening celebrating all that you have accomplished and all that we have accomplished in partnership with you, we pray that you would never cease to hear our thanksgiving for all that you have done. As we dream about the future of our church and who you are calling us to be, we pray that you would continue to inspire us and enable us and empower us to live into those dreams. I thank you for the leaders who have come together to make this church what it is and who have united for this season of leadership in our church. We pray for each person in our church that we might know your call upon our lives and that each one of us might grow love in ourselves, in our families, in our community, and in the world, so that more people would know and follow the way of Jesus. For that is the mission that you have given to us. That is the vision that you have for us as a congregation, and we seek to live into that. So we offer this evening into your hands, and we do so with words of thanksgiving. And all God's people said, Amen. So we want to start tonight by sharing some of our 2017 accomplishments. And I thought I'd start by talking a little bit about our 2017 goals that we presented last year. In our January retreat, our church council set some goals, and I'm not going to put them all up there. They were primarily numeric in nature. Goals for increased worship attendance, numbers of people in small groups, numbers of people participating in missions, numbers of dollars in the offering plate, and so forth. Now, we did monitor those goals throughout the year, and we achieved a couple of them, but I have to tell you that they didn't really drive any ministry, or they didn't really drive any decisions for us in the past year. They were basically just kind of benchmarks and getting a sense of the status of where things are. So we did look at our goals throughout the year, but again, they didn't really drive anything for us. But we did accomplish so much. So I want to run through just a few of the things that we were able to accomplish. We launched a new vision and mission last year at this time. So our new mission is to grow love in ourselves, our families, our community, and the world, so that more people will know and follow the way of Jesus. And we never want to lose sight of the so that. We never want to lose sight of why we're in this. Why do we want to grow love? So that more people would know about the way of Jesus. So our new vision has been the primary driving factor in our ministry planning. It really was the vision and the mission that drove our energies this year rather than any kind of numerical. We also, at the time, as we rolled out our new mission statement, we rolled out a new logo that was intended to show the growth of love. It was intended to connect into our denominational heritage with the cross and flame, but also blend in with our Dublin connections here with some more of the Celtic feel. And I really do think that we have begun to develop some brand identity here at Indian Run. And I want to give a big word of thanks to Wendy Marino and to Carrie Middleton, who really helped make this logo what it is. They spent a lot of hours on that. So thank you. You may have seen the logo on things like t-shirts that I see several of you wearing, or your stickers or magnets on your cars. May see the logos on the pens and the pews. We're really trying to create that sense of brand identity, and I guess that's a little bit of my marketing degree at work in that. So we're excited about our new logo. We also are excited that let me move forward on this. We have several new employees. So we started the year by making Jacob Banger, our permanent contemporary worship leader. He had served on an interim basis for a while. And then after Ginger retired, we had an opening that we filled with someone that didn't end up working out. But now we have Cindy Danko-Southey, who is our new administrative assistant. And Cindy started in November. She is rocking it. She's doing a great job. And we are pleased to have her on our team. We also are thrilled to have a new full-time building manager. We moved from a part-time cleaning service to a full-time building manager last year in Jose Enriquez. Jose has been a tremendous addition to the team. If you've not met him, he's such a genuine, humble spirit and willing to work and do whatever we need, and he's a great addition to our team. And he really has enabled our office staff to do the work that you have asked them to do, rather than doing the work of building maintenance and things like that. So it really has allowed us as an office team to work in a new way. We also moved from part-time youth leadership under Michelle to full-time youth leadership by hiring Nick Mastin. Nick has also been a great addition to the team. It's been nice to have him preaching a couple of times, and good to have another seminary-trained staff person on the team. We also, in mid-year, Ann Reitinger got a full-time job at the preschool, and so we had a change in our Parents Morning Out coordinator, and we were thrilled to welcome Jessica Aldean to the team, and she is here throughout the week, and she's doing a great job as our new Parents Morning Out coordinator. Now, the trustees did a bunch of work last year. They started the year by refinancing the mortgage in partnership with the finance team, and that allowed them to have about $150,000 in funding to take care of some much-needed projects around the church. One of the first projects was the windows in the fellowship hall at the top there. We replaced those windows that were leaking, and then we did a major project of doing the ceiling and painting of the entire building. So it had not been done, and I don't know if it had ever been done since the building was built, and there are many cracks. So now the building, we feel, is fully sealed. We had one leak in the preschool recently, but we've got that pretty much under wraps, and the trustees have done a good job of providing the kind of facilities that we need. Another big update that you see every time you drive in is the new parking lot, ceiling and striping. You can actually see parking spaces now like you couldn't before, so we're thankful for that. Many folks have been thankful for the new handicap entrance that allows folks with differing abilities to enter our facilities without trouble. So that's been really helpful. And then we spoke this morning about our energy efficient lighting. And my button isn't working here. Jacob, you want to hit the next? Can we? There we go. So they embarked on the project of transitioning all the lighting so that not only are we saving thousands of dollars a year in energy costs, but we're saving the labor of anybody here been a part of the team that's replaced these sanctuary light bulbs when they're out, and it's anybody been driven crazy by the light bulb that's out around them, or the variety of kinds of light that we had in the space. So now we have consistent lighting throughout the building. And as we spoke this morning, we'll have the opportunity to offer our used bulbs to a ministry that might be able to take advantage of them. So the trustees have done a lot of good work in keeping our facilities up to date, and they're working continually to develop long-term plans for the building and get ahead of things rather than always playing catch-up. And that's a nice transition that we've made over the last couple of years. We've had continued growth in all of the areas of the church. So I'm going to start kind of with birth through end of life. So our parents' morning out. We offer parents' morning out 3 days a week. Our new director, coordinator Jessica Aldean, is doing a great job. We've got lots of little ones that we are able to impact with the love of God and connect with their families as well. And our preschool does that and more. We have, all right, come on now. There it is. The preschool, 5 days a week, we have over 200 kids, not quite 200 families because some of them are siblings, but we're connecting with so many families in our community, and it really is a shining star of our ministries here and one of the ways that we are well known. This Thursday night, one of the ways that the preschool is growing love is by bringing all the families together for Camp Read-Along. And so it's a night where they're going to be making 800 s'mores, right? And they're going to be sharing, families will be here from 6 to 8 reading with their children. Now, that's ministry, folks. That's bringing families together, ministry use folks. So we are connecting with those families. I get the chance to interact with the families at chapel time once a month. And we want to make sure that we continue that integration with our preschool and connect with those families. Many of our families have come into the life of the church through the ministry of the preschool. Another ministry that we are continuing is our partnership with moms. And they meet one Friday a month, and that ministry has grown. It used to be just one group of ladies sitting around one table, and now there are multiple tables, up to 30 women there that we are impacting connecting with and helping them in their parenting journey. Our children's ministry continues to grow. Under Amy's leadership, we on our Sunday morning counts, when she started here in 2014, it was like a small one-room schoolhouse with less than 10 kids in attendance. This morning, we had 67 kids in church in taking advantage of children's ministry, and there were many more, and you may have heard some of them, in the congregation this morning. And we rejoice at the sound of children in our congregation, don't we? So children's ministry has been and continues to grow. K for J, the small groups for our older elementary school students, continues to be strong and a good transition, good preparing them for middle school and high school youth group. We've grown this past year into family ministry opportunities like the Advent wreath making event and pizza paint and praise. And so we're not just focusing on what are we doing for the children, but what are we doing to help families come together as we live into that element of our mission to grow love within our families. Our youth ministry has grown with full-time leadership now. With Nick at the helm, we now have our confirmation experience is a full school year long experience rather than a 6 to 8 week season, which can feel a lot like a soccer season or a basketball season where you just get her done and then you don't have to worry about it again. What we're trying to do with this school year long experience is offer families an extended engagement with the church so that they can really get a sense of what it means to be a part of the church. So often, folks come and get their kids confirmed and then we never see them again. But we're trying to build that connection with that full-time youth, or full-time year-long confirmation experience. They, youth also have their Thursday night Bible study, and on Sunday nights they have centers for middle school and high school, which was one of our goals for the year, to give them more age-appropriate connections and conversations. Along with our youth ministry, I don't want to fail to mention our scouts. They are an important part of our church. It's an important partnership that we have. We have many Eagle Scout ceremonies each year. We have the benefit of having scouts help us with projects around the church through their Eagle Scout projects, and many of the scouts help on Saturdays where we're cleaning up the yard and the landscaping and whatnot. So our scouts are an important connection. Moving into more adult ministries, we've begun and solidified a Parents of Young Children small group. So we're in ministry to families that and parents who are in that kind of same age span. And continuing on in that spectrum, we also have a small group now for empty nesters. So different experiences of what it means to be a parent and how to reconnect with your spouse and when your kids are now So we're being intentional about finding those opportunities for connection and helping folks make those connections. We also celebrate that the Chinese church is now meeting here every Friday night, with the exception of one Friday night a month. But it was an extended conversation with them to figure out the dynamics of how they might use our facility and how we might ensure that we have the ability to use the facility on a Friday night if we would want to. And we've come to a great partnership with them, and we celebrate that we can grow God's love within the Chinese community here in Dublin, one of the largest Chinese populations in Central Ohio. We have our Owls group has grown. We have other small groups that continue to grow. We have our Owls group that has really strengthened. I think in the past year, there's regular events. There's a good planning team that works on ensuring that we have events for our seniors, our goal is that no group would be excluded in opportunities for connection. We have our care ministries that continue to do a great job with the quilt ministry and our support for military and veterans, the card ministry that they do, the ways that they ensure that everyone feels cared about within the church. We also have our missions, our continued support of the New Life Community Outreach, the Welcome Warehouse that invites people into our church every month. Our Haiti team expanded this year and had an awesome trip that we're going to hear about in 2 weeks. Our ASP mission continues each year. We've got so many different ways that we can give back to God and connect with God through giving of ourselves for the sake of others. So all of these are great ways. There are so many other ways that we have continued the good work, but I just wanted to highlight each of these areas. I'm sure I've missed some. Another area that I'm excited to look at, I'm kind of a numbers guy, but when I look at some of the statistics that we have, so our worship attendance, over the past 3 years, it's grown from about 230 in 2015 up to 265 last year. So we in 2017, we made a 10% growth in worship attendance year over year. Our Easter worship attendance dipped a little bit 1 year, but last year we were at 791 in two services, and the maximum ability for us to seat folks is around 400. So we're busting at the seams on Easter. And so on Tuesday of this coming week, our worship leaders and our children's ministry leaders are going to go to lunch, and we're going to talk about how can we maybe offer a third service for Easter this year so that we can reach more people. How do we work out the logistics of that so that more people can celebrate the resurrection? And so Easter attendance continues to grow. We have our Christmas Eve attendance continues that growth pattern. We have a continual about 10 to 20% growth over the last couple of years. So folks are coming. Folks are connecting with the church. That's good news. We're excited about that. Our I'm In campaign this past year, we had 261 folks respond. Unique individuals responded in a way that they offered their own commitments to God to support the ministries of Indian Run through their prayers, presence, gifts, service, and witness. And so there were commitments that were made in all of those five areas: prayers, presence, gifts, service, and witness. And we are thankful for each and every commitment that was made. We want to help folks live into their call to ministry, their call to serve God in all ways that they can. And each commitment will help us achieve our goals for 2018 and beyond. Our goal for this year was that our average worship attendance for the year, whatever that number is, whatever it landed on, that's how many folks would make a commitment to the church. And we were almost spot on the right number. So we're thrilled about that. Financially, where do we stand? Well, our operating budget in 2017, we had about just over $770,000 in income, and that was 101% of our projection. So we beat our projected income. Our expenses came in at a little over $722,000, and that was under our expense projection. It's about 98% of our budget. So we ended up with a surplus last year of over $48,000. We are thrilled about that because that's going to enable and empower continued ministry in a number of different ways. So if you take a look at what we accomplished last year in comparison to where we have been in previous years, the numbers are pretty small, I know, but you can see the pattern. The orange is the income, the blue is the expenses, and we have come in income over expenses each of the past 3 years. The trend line continues. So what you'll see there is a growth from about a budget of about $600,000 in 2015 to income of over $707,000 in 2017. Now what that tells me is that people are excited and motivated about what's happening here at Indian Run. And it's not just that we receive more money, it's that folks made a choice to give more of what they have for God's purposes. And that, again, gives me goosebumps, because when I think of all the ways that we can invest our money, all the ways that we can spend our money is on our selfish gains, on our on other kinds of things, to invest in God's purposes. I wouldn't be in this job if I didn't think that was the best way of investing. So I really am excited about where we stand. The trend line continues to be great. So our surplus for the last couple of years, on top of operating income. So this is extra mile growth. So in the past 3 years, the trend line again continues. 2 years ago, we received $28,000 in money that went above and beyond the operating budget. Last year, we almost had $80,000 in income that did not go to our operating budget. That's not a part of the $771,000 that I just reported. This is an additional $80,000, so that's almost $850,000 that we received in our income plates for the sake of, or in our offering plates for the sake of God's purposes. And so that is outstanding. Just think of the missions and the ways that money is being spent to further God's kingdom. I'm really excited about again, the growth and the sacrificial giving of our congregation. So the surplus income, I mentioned that we've had a surplus the last couple of years. 2 years ago, it was pretty meager. Last year, we had about $25,000 in surplus. We used $18,000 of that $25,000 to invest in computers and networking services and give our computer system a refresh that it hadn't had in about 5 years. So we did invest that, but we had about $6,000 and change left over from that. This past year's operating surplus we're using to offset some of the trustees' requests for their long-term goals. So we're going to apply $25,000, or almost half of it, to trustees in their long-term goal and planning. We're going to apply about $8,700 of it to our 2018 operating budget, and we'll have $15,000 left in surplus funds that will help us in case a project comes up or in case an expense comes up that we feel the need to invest in without having to ask the congregation for additional income. Along with the growth in our income, we have made a dent in our apportionments. And so we have, our apportionment in 2015, we gave 0% of our connectional giving to the denomination. 0% of what we were supposed to give. In 2016, we used some of our surplus at the end of the year to cover 10% of that of our apportionments. But we made the commitment that starting in 2017, we would grow at a rate of 20% per year, so that in 5 years or less, we would be back up to 100% of our apportionment payments. So in 2017, we paid 20%. And in 2018, we're budgeting to pay 40% of our apportionments. And it will be wonderful when we are finally back up to 100%. We don't have to worry about that anymore. It's just a part of our ongoing budget. So based upon the increases in pledges that we received through the I'm In campaign, our 2018 budget, the finance team met recently and felt that we could set an income projection of about $820,000, just under about $818,000. And we were able to balance that with the expenses. So our ministry leaders at the end of last year were asked to dream big about their budget for the next year. What God-sized dreams do you have for your area of ministry, and what will the budget need to be for those dreams? With the intent that when we gather together, when we get the numbers together, that in January we're going to have to cut some of those dreams, but we'll cut them based upon the goals that we identify for the year. The good news is that we were able to fund 100% of the dreams of our ministry leaders. Everything that ministry leaders have asked for, we have the resources to provide. Again, goosebumps. I've talked about this in several places and in several different situations, and I often say, I just can't believe that happened, and then I catch myself saying that, and I think, well, I'm a person of faith. Why on earth would I not believe that if God is establishing some dreams in our leadership, and God is working in the hearts and minds of those who are thinking about what they are planning to give for the year, why would I think that wouldn't match up? But often it doesn't. And we are in a tremendous financial position. We have the ability to make the kinds of investments that we need to be able to make in order to accomplish the goals. So, and not having to cut anybody's budget request is, I don't want to say unprecedented, but it hasn't happened here in a while, so we're very thankful for that. So let's just take a minute and thank God for all that we have been able to accomplish in 2017 in preparation for what's to come. Thank you, God. Thank you to our ministry leaders. Thank you for the good stewardship of resources. And it's just been a real treat. I can't tell you how easy it is to give a state of the church like this. many of my colleagues are not in that same position. So, where are we headed for 2018? Well, our church council went on retreat on January 7th, and we took a moment to really dream about what it is that God is asking of us and expecting of us and dreaming for us as a church in 2018. And one of the things that kind of ended up shaping that conversation was a concept that I learned along the way in some of my training, and it's very simple. It's a very similar concept to what Nick has learned in his training and in church work. But there's this concept of for all intents and purposes, a ministry funnel. So it doesn't come to an exact, I couldn't get the diagram to not come to an exact point. But it kind of weaves its way down. Now, the idea is that it's patterned after the life of Jesus. So Jesus had interactions with large groups of people. So he fed the 5,000. He had the Sermon on the Mount, and so he had these large group gatherings where he would be in ministry to those large groups. But then there were also opportunities. He sent the 70 apostles out to go serve. So he had smaller group connections, and as the groups got smaller, the connection with Jesus got more intimate and close. Of course, we know that Jesus had his 12 disciples that were kind of his band of brothers that were in ministry with him in that close circle. And within the 12, there were the three, Peter, James, and John, who were Jesus' inner circle. And so each step along this this kind of funnel, you have increasing connection with Jesus, and decreasing numbers. So Jesus had a different level of focus on in connection with the folks at the 5,000 level than he would have with the Peter, James, and John, his three most connected folks. Now, each step along the way, there needs to be an opportunity for folks to move in. It's kind of a discipleship pathway. How are you growing in your faith? How are you moving down? How are you drawing closer to Jesus? And so when we were talking about this as a church council, we thought about it in terms of what are the things that we do as a church that connect with the metaphorical 5,000, that connect with the 70, or that step two. What are the things that we do to connect folks in smaller groups, and how are we connecting at the bottom of that? Now, when folks kind of work their way through that, the closer they get to the bottom and the deeper connection they have with Jesus, it then leads them to begin pouring their lives into the lives of the 5,000. So it's kind of a cycle of discipleship, a pattern of living. And so there's another analogy that we could tie this to for those football fans out there. So you've got folks who are only interested in watching it on TV, but then you get some folks who want to come and tailgate. They'll come and spend the day there, but they're not going to spend $100 on a ticket. So then maybe that's the 5,000. But then you get folks that maybe they want to buy a ticket. But they're not going to invest in the really expensive seats. They're going to be in CDEC or some of the other places, and they're not going to kind of buy the cheap seats. And then you get folks who are willing to make a deeper investment, and they want to be there for every game, and they want season tickets, and they want the best seats they can, and they're going to get the seat backs and all that kind of stuff. And then you have folks who actually are so dedicated, they're going to get on the field, and they're going to coach, and they're going to play, or really be a part of it. So it's the same kind of thing. The numbers grow bigger the farther away, and the more connected you get, the more passionate you are about it. You kind of drive down in numbers. So another way of naming that in church world, these are words that from Nick's training, his training would call the first stage beginning. Then the next stage would be a sense of belonging. And then we move into a sense of believing. And the bottom rung would be becoming. So how do we help folks move through this, draw closer to Jesus, and take steps forward in their life of faith? What are the things that we as a church are doing in each of these areas to help folks who are at that level in their life of faith? So that's kind of where we started thinking about, well, we're pretty good at the blue band, the beginning band. Our worship services and things are good for large groups. We do a pretty decent job. We're getting better at getting our name out there and in the public, and it's a brand identity. But there's kind of a gap in that second phase. We do good at phase three, small groups. We have a thriving small group ministry, one of the best small group ministries that I've seen in any of the churches that I've served. We have a lot of folks in that believing stage, but and I think we have a lot of folks in the beginning stage, but how are we helping folks that are in that belonging stage? How are we connecting folks? And so some of the goals you'll hear tonight have been developed so that we could address the fact that we don't have as many people in that green band as we like. There's kind of a gap there. We have large group fellowship events, we have small group fellowship events, but we don't have any medium-sized group events where people can break down barriers even more. So then we looked at the bottom band, and that's where the real spiritual leadership of the church is. And we identified that we've got a lot of folks in small groups, but we're not getting them down into that next level. We're not giving them the opportunities and or the training and or the resources and or the impact events that would help them clarify that they want to dive deeper in their life of faith. And so we're good at stages one and three, but our goals this year really began to crystallize around stages two and four. And so we landed on four major goals for the year, and then we have one facility goal. So we're going to hear from each of the small groups that worked on these goals. The church council broke into the four different groups, and the leaders further refined those goals, and we're going to hear from someone from each of those groups, so it's not just me talking tonight. But the first goal was to increase connection. So working on that layer two, how do we help folks connect beyond the large group thing? They're not quite ready for a small group, but how do we get them from just being a face in worship to some level deeper of connection? So we're going to hear a little bit more about that. Another goal is to celebrate God's work, to create an attitude of celebration. We recognize that often we talk about all the things that are going on, that are coming up, but we don't do as good a job of celebrating what has been. And so we're going to be intentional about creating a culture of celebration this year. We want to also help every single person in the church take a step forward in their faith. So remember, we have those kind of arrows pointing from one band down to the next. We're going to be intentional this year in thinking about how do we help people take that step to the next band down? How do we increase their faith? How do we increase their connection to Jesus? For if we are not helping people move forward and take a step forward in their faith, what are we about? That's what the church is all about, is it not? Is helping folks dive deeper and make a deeper connection to Jesus. So that's our third goal. Our fourth goal is to cultivate spiritual leaders. And so we'll hear from Brad in a moment about how we plan to develop spiritual leaders. And then our facility goal is to finalize the sanctuary design and make some improvements to this space. And we'll talk a little bit more about what that means. And so at this point, I'd like to invite Amy Catanella to come forward and share with us her team's work on goal number one, on increasing connections and helping us achieve that goal.
So I'm Amy Panella, I'm your director of Children's Ministry, and I want to take an opportunity to introduce to you our, as we currently call ourselves, the Events Committee, a subcommittee of the Church Council. This is Julie Stroop, she is the director of our preschool. This is Sue Weaver, she is our Church Council Secretary, and this is Nick Maston, our youth pastor. And so the four of us answer the call to lead this Events Committee for Church Council, and as Pastor Jeff said, one of our 2018 goals is to provide increased opportunities for connection and to grow love in ourselves, in our families, in our community, in our world, so that more people can know and follow the way of Jesus. And we recognize that we have already been doing some really great things, For instance, last Friday we had our first annual Pizza, Paint, and Praise event, and 44 people of all ages poured out their creativity on the canvas. We had volunteers from the Owl Group who served the pizza and just provided general hospitality for us. And if you were there, you know that lots of love and lots of laughter filled Fellowship Hall, and it really showed us that there is a need for us to find more ways that we can connect with one another as friends, as family, and as children of God. Now, children's ministry, since September, we have already been hosting monthly events. For example, one of the things we were called to do is host Parents' Night Out. And this is helpful to families with young children. And so it gave an opportunity for parents to bring their kids here. We fed them, we took care of them, made sure they were safe, and the parents got to go, whether it was, finishing up their grocery shopping or really just enjoying a night of peace and quiet at home. I can attest that we all could use that sometimes. It was just a way for them to have a little time. So we were reaching those families, those parents, but also we were providing some fellowship opportunity for the kids as well. Last November, we had a time where our congregation could remember the real reason for the season, and we gathered together to make Advent wreaths. Whether you were going to take that home and use it for the first time or you're going to gift it to someone else, it didn't matter to us. We just wanted you to come and fellowship with one another. And we had 17 families that participated in that event. And again, the cookies and punch and general hospitality was provided by the Owl Group. And you kind of hear that pattern there. The Owl Group is kind of a common theme. Sue and I have worked pretty closely together to make that happen because we really, really, well, number one, the Owl Group, I have found, is very generous with their time, their energies, and their resources. But secondly, we really recognize the value of that relationship, that intergenerational relationship. We have a lot to learn from one another. So that's been really great. So as shown, we have already been doing really great things, but we see places to improve to help folks really, come down that funnel. As we met, we talked about all those things that we've really been doing great and the great ideas that we have to feed ourselves within the church, but we also really, really see the need to go outside of our comfort zones maybe and reach out to our community because, we want to remember that after all, our mission is to grow love in all different ways and all different places. So I'm really excited to invite all of you to the Tables of Eight event. Hopefully you've heard about that in our various communications over the last week or so. If you haven't, please grab one of us. We'd be happy to share those details with you and really encourage you to think about participating. And if tonight you decide to do that, we just happen to have a sign up outside of the narthex. So you can participate in various ways. So we just ask you to just consider doing that. And it's just a great way to get to know your church family. In addition to that, the Owls Group is hosting a bingo event this month, and something new this year that we've been blessed with the opportunity, our own Jim Weaver, actually, he's donated his time and his energy to bring us a class for parents. And the class, we'll share more details about that, but it's really a class that all of us as parents can really benefit from. So I'm just thinking about, that old saying, babies don't come with manuals. Again, I can attest to that as well, but we just want to create ways that we can help parents along this journey. Stay tuned for more information about that four-week class coming. Next, March is going to bring us into the season of Lent and Easter, and we're having a church-wide study that we invite you to be a part of. And again, if you haven't yet signed up for that, there's a sign-up out on the narthex. You can visit that afterwards. In April, we have planned to host a game night here at church, and that's just as simple as it sounds. We want you to bring your games, your card games, your board games, and just come have fun. It doesn't matter how old you are. It doesn't matter if you're coming alone or coming with your family. We just want you to come, have some fellowship. And then also, we have a ladies' tea scheduled as well that ladies will be invited to. And then we are going to literally dive right into summer at Linda Jones' house. Ladies are invited to a pool party, and we want to take the opportunity to get outside during the warm months. We want to support a men's golf outing. A movie night is something new. We want to really focus on with the Dublin Wind Symphony and have an ice cream social, gather everybody together and do that. We want to continue to go to a Clippers game. We going to have an old-fashioned family-style picnic here at the church sometime in August. The other thing, so as we're talking about getting out in the community, we want to head out into Dublin during the All-City Workday, and with the cleanup projects in Maine, we'll get together. We're hoping that small groups will team up, but of course we, as church council, will host you here in the morning and give you a healthy breakfast to be able to go out and do good work. And then fall brings us lots and lots of back-to-school activities within our preschool and our community schools. And we'll have a back-to-school night here for preschool parents, and then we'll also have our fall festival. We hope to really amp that up this year and not just take care of our preschool families and our church preschool families, but we really want to invite the whole community. So we're looking to make that a much larger event this year. And our intent is to expand our relationship with Dublin Food Pantry and Welcome Warehouse, and especially during that back-to-school time, think about ways we can support those kids that don't have everything they need necessarily to go back to school, such as school supplies and backpacks. And I mean, they're really, some of them are in our backyards that don't have those sort of resources, so we really want to amp up those ways and give back to the community as well. In October, we really love our time at the Spooktacular. We reach the whole community and even more that way. We're able to invite them here, let them know about our programs. And something that I think has been especially on my heart, we have lots of folks among us that maybe don't have families or close friends here with them during the holiday season. So we're thinking, let's host a Thanksgiving family potluck. We don't have family here, and I know many of us are in that same boat, so I'm thinking it would be super cool for us to be able to come together and, have family and friends around us for Thanksgiving or Christmas. Just to be able to remember the reason for the season, we want to keep up the Advent leaf making event, things like that. And then lastly, in December, we have planned a cookie making event. And our plan is that we will bake cookies and have everybody come and decorate those. And then we want to give back to those who sacrificed so much to keep us safe. So maybe we'll deliver those to the police station, the local firehouses. And then another intent is that we partner with organizations who help us send those cookies overseas to the servicemen and women who are away from their families during that time of year. So I just want you to know that that's not a comprehensive list. We know that there are lots and lots of other things going on. We encourage and we recognize that other areas of ministries will be hosting their own events. But generally, I just hope you have a sense of how excited we are for 2018. We're just so thankful for all the ways that God has blessed us and for the generosity of you, the congregation. And together, I really think that we can accomplish those goals. So we just invite you to get together.
Thank you. So now I'd like to invite Amy Edwards on behalf of goal team number two to come forward and share. We didn't plan a whole big extended thing like that, so we're not going to be able to do that.
Yeah, thank you, God. I'm trying to keep that. But along the same lines, goal number two is to celebrate God's work in and through Amy Run, which in a way is to celebrate all the fabulous things that Amy just talked about and all the other things that we have yet to see. The key way we're going to do this is we're going to do a grow love moment each week. And what is a grow love moment? It's a personal, positive story talking about something that happened here at the church and focusing on how we saw God work through that event and how we grew love through that event. It's also important to mention that when we do talk about that and celebrate it, there's three things that it's not. We're not asking for money, we're not asking for volunteers, and we're not asking you to join me or join my team or a team. We just want to celebrate and appreciate and acknowledge the way God is with us and works through us through these events. So to do a grow love moment consistently, we put together a protocol of how we're going to do this. So the worship team and office staff is going to put together a schedule of these grow love moments. So we will have 52 grow love moments, which after Amy's speech, that is not going to be difficult to do. And then we have a template put together that the office is going to send to the event leader. And this template is just helping them think about the event in terms of how God is working through us, and just kind of letting them get their head around it. So it'll ask for a summary of event, who's involved in the event, how they saw God work through them in the event, and how did we grow love. So then after the event leader will fill out that template and hopefully get a whole bunch of pictures and send those to Wendy or to Cindy right after the event. And they will get the information together. And then you'll see that as a congregation in four different ways. So we're going to have a Grow Love moment in worship every Sunday. And then if you've missed Sunday's worship, you're going to see a follow-up email on Monday and social media kind of highlighting the event. We're also going to send an email to the small group leaders and hope that they can highlight it during the prayers and praises moment of their small group time. And then lastly, they'll see it on slides out in the narthex at the Welcome Center. And all of these will have an accompaniment of a graphics that Wendy Marino put together that you'll see as a constant theme throughout. It's just so, we just want to make sure that we are celebrating and thanking God for, you know, working through us and helping us to grow love in the community. Thanks.
Thanks, Amy.
Now we'd like to invite Dave Cochran to come forward and share with us the work of Goal 3's small group of enabling and empowering each person in the church. Take a step forward.
Well, Nick said that I was supposed to do this with an interpretive dance, and I was all set to do that. Sadly, I was splitting firewood yesterday and threw my back out, so you'll have to work over that. So the committee that worked on this one was Nick Maston, Sean Cotter, who cleverly went to Europe, so he didn't have to do the interpretive dance, and Jerry Russo, who wisely sat in the back. So we struggled a little bit with this one, I have to say. This one's a little bit fuzzier and harder to quantify in any way, but we talked for quite a while and ended up coming up with basically three general strategies that would encourage people to kind of try, or that hopefully will encourage people to take that next step in their faith journey. So the first really is greater communication about the opportunities that are out there. We've heard from Jeff and also from Amy about some of the things, well, actually both Amy's, about a number of the things that we are trying to do, and we heard about the IU campaign commitments, etc. I think one of the key things that hit us all was we really wanted to be very consistent and try to link together these various activities to encourage people to move from event to event and become more intentional about advertising, in air quotes. What's next? What are the next thing that you might be interested in doing here at the church? We also talked a little bit about sort of the brief presentations, the Grow Love moment idea for all the small groups who did, at least at the time we're starting something new in a small group, it'd be really good to stand up and just have a general invitation. Here's what we're doing. Happy to have you join. So that's sort of the first cluster of ideas. The second is really getting more intentional about encouraging people to take that next step. So, I think we've heard a ton about of all the things that are going on here. This is sort of the Indian Run equivalent of Amazon. When you're shopping, you get the little thing that says, people who looked at what you were looking at also bought this. So it's essentially take the next step. And really, a couple ideas here. Number one, we'd really like to, by Easter, try to have a cadre of people who've been identified and are willing to, sort of go around and soft sell to our congregation, you know, what are the other things that you might be interested in doing? You know, I think Jeff is always really good in sermons and probably most of the time sort of challenging everybody to take that next step. And I think, you know, we all need to be as intentional as possible about trying to, you know, nudge our peers along to take that next step. One of the other things we talked about was having some sort of table parents for the brunch ministry, you know, just somebody who could be knowledgeable about what's going on, you know, do some of that sharing, do some of that nudging, and let people, you know, have people get an opportunity to meet other folks at the church. And, you know, if you rotated those people around, you would be able to have, you know, people get a bigger network here at the church. And then, you know, thirdly, one of the things that, because everybody's time is pretty limited, we thought it might be helpful, particularly for that, moving that top to the second band, it might be helpful to develop a series of, you know, just really short studies on various topics, preferably a whole variety, you know, kind of a wide variety of them. Things that would be kind of maybe a low commitment, suck in, and get you, you know, realizing, hey, this is, you know, this is interesting, this is something that would be, you know, good for people who haven't really made the commitment to join a small group. And, you know, another aspect that might be interested, you know, time is limited. We have all sorts of technology in this world. You know, it's a reason you can't do Bible study by Skype, for example. So I think that was everything that this group came up with. So.
Thanks, Dave. We appreciate the work of that group. Our fourth group was the spokesperson for the group will be Brad Mathers, and we'll be talking about how we intend to develop spiritual leaders.
I first of all want to thank all the chefs who made the soup tonight. Whoever made the mango infused salsa chili was kicking. Wow, what's good stuff. It was a privilege to work with my small group, and it consisted of Bill Delaney, Jim Weaver, and Pastor Jeff on the very bottom of the funnel. Sorry?
Lisa Cotter.
And Lisa Cotter, too. I'm sorry, Lisa. She's kind of always involved in everything, so I kind of take her for granted that she works with. When the group met, we really came to the inexorable conclusion that God wants everybody on the bus. And if I could extend that metaphor a little bit further, not only does he want us on the bus, he wants us in the right seat, the seat that's best suited for us to be able to use the skills and the gifts that he has blessed each and every one of us with. Helping folks to find out if you are being called into a leadership seat on the bus is what goal number four is all about. Now, we're calling it Cultivate Spiritual Leaders. Notice we're not calling it Recruiting Church Leaders, because we believe very strongly that God has blessed everyone in this room with skills and abilities. And if you recognize that, then you will come to a decision in your own life that you're being called to some type of leadership role, at whatever level it might be. Now, from discussions with a number of clergy and lay leaders over the years, I've come to the conclusion by personal experience, it takes a lot of work between you and the good Lord to find out what your calling is. And you may be called to a variety of types of ministry, but you may be being called to a deeper level of service here at Indian Run, some type of leadership role. But I want to emphasize that if you begin to go through this process that goal number four is going to lay out for you, it's not an obligation to take on a senior leadership role at the church. No obligation to say, yes, I'll be the chair of trustees, or yes, I'll be on SBRC. What it does obligate you to do is recognize if God's calling you to some type of service, whether it's here or someplace else in the kingdom. So here is how we intend to implement the process. The first tactic is to ask you to join the Lenten study. We've already talked about that this evening. We hope everybody in the congregation will attend the Lenten study to begin to discern the process of what are my gifts. How am I called to serve? The second part we're calling Answering God's Call 2001. And that's going to be a study that will take place immediately after the Lenten service. Now, if there are sufficient people responding to it, we may offer it again in the fall so we can make sure we get to everybody who wants to be involved in it. Answering God's Call 201 is going to be a 4 to 6 week study that will help you discern God's call if you think you're being called into some type of leadership role. It will involve the use of gift inventories and other methods to help you find out whether you belong on a seat on the bus that could give some type of leadership at the church. And then also will be kind of in a small group format. The next tactic is to what we're calling equip the equippers. During the spring, while the Lenten series is going on, before we get into the 201 course, Pastor Jeff is going to work with a select group of people, some experienced church leaders, to help them become mentors slash coaches. And those folks, in turn, who are going to begin working these coaches and mentors will then begin working with Jeff, with each one of the people who was a graduate of the 201 course. So you'll have an opportunity for the rest of the entire year to meet one-on-one with Jeff and your coach to help define your gifts, to understand further whether or not you're being called into service here at the church. So that's going to take you from the summer all the way to the end of the year. If good Lord's willing, by the end of the year, we hope we will have identified some leaders who are going to step forward and say they'll help us lead the congregation into the future or to some other type of ministry service outside the walls of the church. So if you're called, if you enroll in the 201 course, be prepared for a life-changing experience.
Thank you, Brad.
So as I mentioned, we also have one final goal, which is around our facilities, and specifically this space. And you, as you've known for a while, we've been intentional in updating some of the technology aspects. The AV systems are not what we would particularly like them to be. So in the coming year, the church council felt like we've got to get this done. We've got to call it finished. And so we're going to be looking at the audio equipment. We'll be looking at sound tiles. One of the things that's been identified is that this room echoes more than any other space like this should for the kinds of things that we do in this space. And that's why the sound gets so muddy and muddled, and that's why it's difficult to hear. So you see that panel of sound tiles back there. Well, the sound engineers, they're up on the top of the wall there, they would love to just coat every inch of wall space with sound tile, but we obviously don't want that. So we're going to take a big picture view of how we might incorporate that. We'll be also be looking at adding some hearing assist devices, and we've already got them identified, and we're ready to kind of, that's kind of a shovel-ready project, I guess we might call it. But we want to ensure that those who are in need of hearing assistance would be able to have it. We also want to ensure that video projection is no longer the challenge that it often is when there's a really sunny day or a dark video or things like that. We want to make sure that everybody can see what is being presented on the wall. Now, that might incorporate, you know, there's lots of ideas on that. Could it be a screen? Could it be different kinds of paint? Could it be any number of different things? That's why we want to gather a team together to look holistically and the full picture of the sanctuary. We want to be looking, where the trustees are already working on getting some blinds on the back doors back there so that on Sunday mornings during the summer, I can actually see you and not be blinded by the reflection off the cars. The choir will appreciate that as well. We'll also be thinking about blinds up here and on these windows so that when we want to have full dark in the room, we have that capability. So that would be another consideration. We want to think about the interior design of the room. This is a fairly beige palette that could do with some interior design, right? So, but we want to be smart about that and do things that will incorporate elements of the design that might actually help with the sound echoing and things like that. We want to be thinking about stage lighting. We've got, now that we have all LED or energy efficient light bulbs in here, we have cut the wattage down significantly so that we can have more banks of flexibility of different kinds of dimmers. And we'd like to have better stage lighting so that we can highlight just the choir or just the praise band or just this section or just the altar. And that is a possibility with some intentionality this year. We want to take that panel off the wall, that industrial steel panel where all of the light switches are hidden, and turn it into something that you don't have to have a PhD to operate, and make it easy for folks who want to use the facility. So we're going to be gathering a team to focus on this work, again, ensuring that we are taking a long-term, big-picture view of it, and that we're not just getting siloed into what might work for me, but it doesn't work for the rest of the congregation. So me being any number of these that might participate in that conversation. So some things will be quick fixes, like the hearing assist devices. Some things will take more time to integrate into the bigger picture and the long-term planning for the space. The good news is that we already have $20,000 that is earmarked for this work. And that'll get us a decent portion of the way there, but I'm sure that you will be hearing about additional opportunities for you to participate in renovating this space so that we can have the kind of sanctuary that will function for us now, but also into the future. So that's a main goal for getting done this year. Now there's some other things that are going to happen in the life of the church this year that I just want to quickly talk about. One of the things that Wendy's currently working on is an online church directory, and also the opportunity for, it would offer the opportunity for you to put your own picture on it, or on a Sunday morning we would have a backdrop and we can get your picture taken so that we can have an updated pictorial directory in a way that is updatable and doesn't, the minute you print a photo directory, it's out of date. So, but we would also have the capability of printing copies of this online directory for those who would need a printed copy. So we'll be talking about that. The trustees are currently working on clarifying our building use policies, and as we continue to open our doors to an increased number of outside groups, we really need to make sure that we are clear on what those policies are. Nick and Amy are working on revisions to our safe sanctuaries policies so that we can be sure that we are doing our absolute best to protect youth, children, and vulnerable adults. And so we never, ever want our church to be a space where anyone is violated or treated in a way that is not honoring to God. And so we are working on updating that. You'll be hearing more about our safe sanctuary policies this year. You may have noticed that the sign is missing from the roundabout, and the trustees are continuing to work with the city and get the sign replaced. And then the bike path. Now, this is something that's been on many of our hearts and minds for a while, but each year, our board of representatives are given the opportunity to endorse or encourage one improvement project to the bike paths around the neighborhood. So this year we are going to work hard to put the right pressure on the right person so that we can get the bike path connected from the roundabout to the other edge of the property so that we can have folks able to make their way on foot or on bicycle or whatever to our church. Now that's not going to happen, it's not going to be complete this year, but that's a goal to get that in the right way. So if you know somebody who knows somebody or can help us apply the right pressure and get on that list, we feel like that's something that we want to encourage Dublin to make an investment in. So what can you do to help? Oh, there's so much more that we're going to be doing this year. We've talked about a lot. There's a lot going on, but it's good stuff begets good stuff. And it's an exciting time in the life of our church. So how can you? Just like last year, there are two ways. You can pray and you can participate. So we do need your prayers, and we'll be working on a prayer that might guide your praying that we would distribute to the whole church. So maybe a printed prayer that you could include in your regular prayer life. You could make it a bookmark in your Bible or something like that. And then participate. There are a million things that you heard about tonight. Get involved. Help us lead some of those efforts. Take that next step of faith that is appropriate for you. We really need everyone to be a part. Now, we're going to have a time of Q&A, but before we do so, I want to make mention that we have a listing of our church leadership. It's available if you're interested in just recognizing or seeing who's leading the church this year. It's available on the usher stand on your way out the door. Also, at the end, we would like to, if you're not the kind of person that's comfortable standing up in front of a mic and asking a question or providing feedback or anything like that, we have some pieces of paper. We would covet your feedback and would love for you to take a moment to tell us what you think about all the things that you heard tonight, some ideas that you might have, some words of wisdom that you might have. We again, covet that feedback. So at this time, though, I'd like to invite our church council members to come forward to stand up here so you can get a visual of who they are, and then we have three mics around the room, and we'll invite your questions, and the church council member most appropriate would be able to answer to the best of their ability. So we'll invite them to come forward, and then if you have a question and you're ready to go, you can step on up to the mic. Somebody's got a question. Fine, get up. We got 10, too. All right.
I'm not going to ask my question.
Yeah, can you hear?
Explain in 1 minute, explain apportionments. I've been a member here a long time, and I still don't quite understand. If we have a surplus, how do we get away with not paying our percentage of apportionments?
So a lot of thought went into that. Apportionments are our what the denomination likes to call connectional giving. Other people call it church taxes. But it's our fair share of denominational expense. So it goes to pay our bishops and district superintendents. It goes to fund ministries that support, that happen within the district. There's a fund that we pay into that builds a fund for the district to give grants to churches that are in need of additional funding to accomplish a particular goal. It goes to, as a part of our apportionments, we support Africa University, which is a United Methodist institution in the Congo. Our apportionments go around the world. That's how our denomination is funded. Now, we made a choice a couple of years ago to go down to solve our budget by ceasing our apportionment payments, much to the chagrin of our annual conference and the district superintendent, who asks me about it just about every time she sees me. And so one of the things that we wanted to do was be able to pay to get our way back up in a sustainable way. So if we used all of our surplus funding to pay maybe 60% of this year's apportionments, our total apportionments are about $70,000 a year. And that's calculated based on our attendance and, our membership and our operating budget. So what they do is they take all of the churches in the West Nile Conference and total up their membership and divide it by however many. We get a percentage based on however many members we have, and then another portion of the formula, they take everybody's operating budget and divide it, so it's an equal share. We decided not to grow beyond the 40% next year, or pay more for this year, so that we could demonstrate that pattern of growth, so that we wouldn't get up to 40% this year for 2017, and then have to dip back 30% in 2018, or, the conference prefers, it's easier, I think, on the leadership of the church and for us, for me personally, to show that upward growth each year rather than kind of dipping. So we wanted to do it in a sustainable way. Is that, Bill, do you have anything else that you would add to that?
No, I think think usually if in your own personal budget you have something that you had to cut out and you want to bring it back in, you normally bring it back in stages as opposed to jumping in and paying it on. I think that's what we were doing here. That's a plan that's, you know, that's okay with everybody.
Yeah, my question is in regard to the refinancing. Now, you mentioned that you know, there was $150,000 that I limited understanding that would be cash flow for the church. And I'm just curious what happened to the $150,000.
Yeah, Bill or Dave, you're on trustees. Most of it went to cover the projects that were outlined that the trustees accomplished. The vast majority of it went to the ceiling of the exterior of the building, which was $100,000 or something like that. So
it showed up as revenue and then an expense.
It was set aside in, this is almost a Lisa King question, a bookkeeper question, but it was received as income when we refinanced the mortgage, and it was set aside in a special fund simply for trustees. And then the trustees have been using it. We have $30,000 left in it or something like that.
Something like that.
But we did the windows with it, we did the exterior of the building, and we did the ceiling of the parking lot with that funding last year.
Very good.
What was that growth from the 650 to 770 year over year? Include that 150 or
no?
That's totally separate.
Totally separate. What other question? Yeah. Communion offerings, ASP, they're giving to support ASP, giving to support Haiti, giving to support anything that didn't go into our operating budget.
Gotcha.
So,
thank you.
Yeah. Is it 250 of the 350? Yeah.
So in 4 years?
In 4 years, that note will be paid off and we'll be debt free. Yeah, come on.
First of all, I'd like to commend everyone, and I was happy to see also the safe sanctuary policy approach. I know for this district, I have signed up to go to that session because in today's world, it's one of those where you have to, just like I read about a car wash, having, you know, things done. Maybe you heard the Kentuckyism coming out of my mouth when I said that. So I want to commend everybody, and I applaud you for the great work because I know it takes a lot, and I'm happy to hear about that too. That people feel safe when they bring their children, their relatives, their friends. So thank you.
Thank you. I'm not sensing a lot of interest in coming up to microphones, but I'm sure I am sure there are other comments or questions or ideas out there. So as you head back, could you help? So we'll take a few moments and we'll pass these out. And thank you to the church council leadership of our church. Before you get too caught up in writing your words on the card, let's close with a word of prayer. Oh Lord, you have clearly given big dreams to this congregation. You've heard our response in these moments, and we pray that you would continue to help shape and mold all that we would do. For we don't want to do anything unless it is pleasing to you and in accordance with your will. Continue to guide and strengthen our leadership, guide and strengthen each member of our congregation so that each one of us can take that important next step of faith that you're calling us to take. Help us to be in this together as a church so that we can celebrate together, we can grieve together, we can support one another, and we can bear witness to your abundant love together. Set us forth from this place to a night of rest and relaxation, to whatever ministry that you're calling us to do in the remaining hours of this day, and give us a night of restful sleep so that we can awake in the morning, renewed and energized, to do the ministry that you're calling us to do. And when we reach the end, we will never fail to give you the glory. We pray all of this in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Thank you to each and every person. We will, and if you want to complete a note, do we have the, I'm sorry? Oh, children are in Celebration Hall preschool area, and you can, we'll put an offering plate that you can put your suggestions and notes in. But thank you, everyone, for being here tonight. Thanks, everyone, for helping make it happen.